Good evening. Sorry. Good evening. Welcome to this regular meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. It is Monday, March 11th, and would the town clerk call the roll, please?
Chairman Swift Kayada.
Here.
Counselor Barry.
Here.
Counselor Carson.
Here.
Counselor Fritz.
Here.
Counselor Lynch.
Here.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
Counselor Roberts.
Here.
And Manager McGovern.
Here.
And our town clerk?
Here.
Thank you. Pledge of allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. I have a presentation for which I'm going to move down to the other podium. Could we have the Cape Elizabeth Girls Swim Team and the coaches come up to the front, please? How do we want to do this? Why don't you sort of face that one?
Line up.
Yeah, line up.
Ben brought the crowd.
Well, we have very exciting news here. I want to congratulate the girls' swim team on a very successful season. And in honor of them, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council has a proclamation, which I will read to you. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth girls' swim team earned the 2002 Maine Class A State Championship, and whereas this victory was the result of extraordinary effort in the state meet from a balanced team featuring one of the nation's best swimmers and depth in nearly every event, and whereas the final score showed that the team was clearly the best in the state of Maine with an overwhelming victory margin of 86 points and first place finishes in 9 of the 12 events, and whereas this championship is the culmination of thousands of practices over many years with devoted attention to swimming and diving by the girls themselves, as well as by coaches, parents, and other volunteers, now therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth High School girls swimmers and divers on the state championship, and we salute them, their coaches, their parents, and all others whose efforts helped lead to this victory. And it's dated the 11th of March, 2002, and signed by the town council. Congratulations. I don't know who's a captain or if a co-captain or coach would like to say something. They let their actions speak louder than their words. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, we're off to a good start there. Reports and correspondence. Anything from the counselors? Mr. Roberts.
Madam Chair, I would like to just mention that a week and a half ago, I guess now, myself and Counselor Swift Kayada and Lynch went to the school board budget meeting. I was impressed with the amount of effort that the town school or the school staff had put into the budget and was pleased with their efforts. And obviously we'll be meeting in the future to deliberate further on the whole financial matter. I would like to just again reiterate that I for one am extremely upset that the state of Maine would consider cutting $600,000 from any school district in 1 year. And if people in the town are as upset as I am, they really ought to be contacting the governor's office. Your own representatives have done their best to meet the challenges and get some additional funding, but other people in the state need to hear that this is just is wrong to be cutting that kind of money from any district in the state in 1 year. And I'll stand on that, I guess. But thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Roberts. Anything else? Councilor Fritz?
Yeah, I'd just like to once again encourage Cape Elizabeth High School seniors to consider applying for the essay competition that's being sponsored by Regional Waste System, which has as award to the winner a $1,500 scholarship to a 2 or 4 year college. Information can be found on the web if you go to www.regionalwaste.com or org. Any student must live in the community served by Regional Waste System. The application deadline is April 15th, and or people could also call 773-6465. So it's a good scholarship opportunity, so I'm encouraging high school seniors to apply.
Councilor Fritz wants to see someone from Cape Elizabeth win that this year. So. Okay, I have two brief things. I would just like to mention that on Friday night, Cape Play, the playground fundraising organization, had an auction at Perpudic, and it was very nice. It was very well attended. I was very impressed with how many people turned out, and it was a really nice event and very well done, and I want to congratulate them, and I'm sure we're going to hear a couple items down the agenda how well they did, but it looked like a great crowd and like everybody was having a good time. And then for a different event Saturday evening, I know several of the other counselors and I attended the fire department's lobster stew dinner, which I had never attended before, but I think I'm going to put on my calendar every year from now on because it was good food. And I just want to congratulate them for a job well done on that event. It was really nice. I had a good time, and I know everybody else did there, too. It was also very well attended. So big social events in Cape Elizabeth this weekend, so thank you. No more reports or correspondence? No? Then the town manager's report, please. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, good. Thank you, Madam Chair. A couple of brief items. First, I want to congratulate Sandra Hanscom on her retirement. She actually left a few months ago as the office manager in the Assessing Codes Planning Office, but in the last few months, she's been helping out on a temporary basis in the just outside the dispatch area at the police fire station. And she's worked for the town for over 20 years. We had a little get-together for lunch last week and mentioned at that when she first came to Cape Elizabeth, we didn't have computers to speak of. So we've made quite a bit of progress in the last 20 years, and Sandra was instrumental first in the tax office, then in the Assessing Codes Planning Office, and then more recently helping out with the transition of all the different public safety spaces with so many activities, and really want to express my appreciation, and I know the community's to her for all of her efforts over the last 20 years. Secondly, I did want to mention that the police station is coming along very well. For those that go by at night now, you can see there's lights on and there's doors. And you get a pretty good view looking in. It should be complete in about a month. We still don't have an exact move-in date, and we don't plan to have one until we're satisfied that all the communication systems are up and running. But everything seems to be going along just fine with it. We've been very pleased with the contractor's work, very pleased with the architect's work, and it is coming in under budget as well, so we're also pleased about that. Citizens should look for an article soon, either on the web page or in some other publications, kind of doing an overview of all our municipal projects and seeing what they're all costing and the impact on taxes. I was surprised, and I know the council has seen the drafts of this, quite surprised to see that all of these projects have been undertaken over the last few years have actually had not much of an impact on taxes, although they have had an impact. The final point about the police station I did want to mention is we are planning an open house for Memorial Day, which is the same time the fire department has their traditional open houses. Felt a lot of people are out and about in the town center that day, and that's probably the maximum opportunity for folks of all ages to be able to come in and to see both the fire station as well as the police station. So at the very least, it'll be done by Memorial Day, but we're hoping it'll be sometime in April.
Great. Thank you very much. Moving on, citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to bring something to our attention? Hearing none. We'll move on to the minutes for our February 11th meeting. Do I hear a motion?
I move acceptance of the minutes as written for us.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Yeah, I think that Councilor Lynch has a new telephone number that was different from the one reported in the minutes here.
Councilor Lynch, is that your phone number?
Say.
No.
I think it's very important that the citizens be able to be...
Nothing escapes, Councilor Perry.
This looks the same.
That is no longer my telephone number.
Henry, I am impressed. Well, just for the sake of the record, what is your phone number that should be written down here?
It is 767-5788.
767-5788. Anything else?
To clarify, you have one fewer telephone.
I have one fewer telephone, that's right.
Thank you, Councilor Berry.
My pleasure.
Is any further discussion or corrections? None? All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
I only call it during the daytime.
Okay. Item number 93, action on a report from the Conservation Commission regarding St. Bartholomew's easement area boardwalk. Do you have anything to say about this, Mr. Manager?
I would like me to.
Does anyone feel the need for an introduction?
Mike Duddy, the chairman of the commission, is here.
Okay. Mike, are you out there? Oh, there you are. Couldn't see you behind the playground group there, so please come forward.
After the work, Madam Chair, after the workshop with the town council, it was our understanding that the council was looking for a plan, or at least a further recommendation or refinement of the vote that we had taken at the commission level, which was essentially to take the minimal steps necessary to preserve the easement. What you have in your packets for this meeting is essentially the contractor's estimate for a boardwalk.
Excuse me, could you turn this mic so the people at home can hear you? That's great, thanks.
What you have in the packets is the contractor's estimate for a large, shouldn't say large, but a more sophisticated boardwalk than that which several of us were talking about during the workshop. The thought being is that the area where the boardwalk will be necessary is a very difficult area to build in. I've been out on that spot several times now. There may be areas along that path that will accommodate a less sophisticated boardwalk, but there are areas that may take more. At this time of year, it's very hard to determine that because a lot of it is frozen, and although you can see it, you can't get a good solid sense of how much water is standing on the surface, whether it would accommodate the kind of two-plank wide boardwalk on logs that exist down at Great Pond, or whether that would just be a never-ending headache to maintain. What we thought would be appropriate at this point, since it's not spring yet, is to give you essentially what the maximum would look like if we had to bridge the whole area, so to speak, with a boardwalk that's up over it, that's not going to sink into it, and therefore might be easier to maintain over time. But we'd still like some flexibility in making that field assessment come spring about exactly what would be necessary to not only preserve the easement, but not to put something out there that is going to be so minimal as to require constant maintenance and upkeep. And beyond that, I'm here to answer questions. I would add that following the letter that Mr. Chinquette sent in to his attorney, Attorney Perkins, I called Attorney Perkins and had a very collegial discussion with him about the whole situation. He represents that his client is more than willing to help walk and locate boardwalk and consider other options in the future if the discussion proceeds, but I thought I ought to add that as well.
So am I to take it that the recommendation is for the type of boardwalk that in this memo is called Option 3, Figure 4? The bog bridge with sleepers?
It is for, I don't actually have it in front of me now.
It's a date of February 28th.
The option, this is confusing for you. would like to have the ability, if necessary, to go with option one, if the area is so wet that you literally can't have the two-plank-wide boardwalk on sleepers. But in the spring, we may feel more satisfied that there are areas, enough areas of solid ground that's not necessary. It's just very hard to determine at this point. My fear is that we come in and say, look, all we're going to need is option three, which is the most minimal type of boardwalk, and you're going to get out there in the spring, and you're going to put a sleeper down, and it's going to disappear.
Right.
And so rather than have us literally fighting that kind of physical challenge out there, would like to have the option to do something a little bit more permanent, or at least a little bit easier to maintain, that will be up out of literally the standing water.
So your recommendation then is to, at the minimum, do the option three, figure four, but to have the option of sort of upgrading up to option one, the wooden walkway, elevated boardwalk, if in places where it might be necessary because of the terrain?
Precisely.
Okay. And the cost estimate, the minimum would be $5,700 if you could do this option three all the way through. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And then if you were going to do, I'm trying to figure out what's the maximum.
The maximum is the option one, the $18,000 figure.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for clarifying that.
I have a question. I'm not sure who can best answer it, but in either event, that is option one or option three or some combination thereof, are we working, are you proposing to work with funds within your allotted budget from last year, or are you looking for any new funds?
No, we're not looking for any new funds.
Thank you.
Okay. Good question. Councilor Fritz.
I don't like the looks of option one in terms of using poles. It doesn't make sense to me that a pole would, made out of metal is going to be stable enough. I mean, I think you'd be a lot better off with, you know, 4x4 kind of posts or, you know, I mean, I don't want to get into the detail of this, but I don't care for the option one. I hope that we can go the least, you know, invasive, I guess, and most natural looking. I'd really like the opportunity to take you and Maureen to a site that has a boardwalk that's sitting in, pretty much sitting in water between two ponds that has lasted a considerable length of time, that's designed a lot like option three. So that you can see how that's put in, that I think would be cost effective and work very well. But I guess I'd also like to clarify a little bit about, I'm concerned that this project take place, not just the boardwalk being built, but that all the work on the alternative signage be done at the same time, simultaneously, so that we can get people to take a path that makes sense, not just end in this spot because we're building only a boardwalk. I wanted to clarify, just for my own thinking, about in order to claim actual possession for the town of the pond, we would have to improve in some way the walk around the pond. Is that correct? Like with chips or something like that. Not boardwalk, but chips.
We already legally own the rights around the pond now. The issue is if we don't take action, those rights will be extinguished.
Right. That's what I'm referring to. So we not only have to do the boardwalk, but around the pond.
So you're just saying, let's do the whole length of the thing, whether it's a boardwalk or not. Do whatever is the most minimal.
Right, and
to preserve our rights.
Encourage people to go on the alternative path. So clearing of brush in order to do that. And I just, because I had a conversation with Pam Mullen today and was saying that in her request for a fence to between the pond and their property. And I wasn't considering at the time I was talking with her that we would be improving the path around the pond. Is that right? Is that the council's plan in order to keep that easement?
I'm sort of losing you here on the fence and the... You're trying to count the fence that she's talking about as being an improvement and therefore we will have met our obligations?
And, I mean, this proposal is basically addressing the boardwalk alone. But if I'm understanding correctly, the easement is temporary until, for a certain length of time, until we make some improvements, and then the area will be defined 15 feet out from that. So it's not just the boardwalk, but a path around the pond if we want to keep the pond as part of the easement. Is that correct?
What the conservation easement says is that the path goes to and by the pond. And then, as you're correct, there's some elasticity to the easement. It starts out a certain way, then once you build the boardwalk, it then provides for a certain amount of footage. And but you referenced a minute ago about the council's plan. The council's plan was simply to ask the Conservation Commission to develop a proposal, which they've now done. I don't think the council has a plan. It's before you this evening,
right,
what the Conservation Commission is recommending.
Perhaps this question would clarify. When we're talking mostly about the boardwalk here, but you would also be proceeding with the rest of the aspect of that trail that doesn't need a boardwalk, but this just needs either chips or brush clearing or whatever it needs,
yeah,
the drier part.
Yeah, that's exactly right. What we put in front of you was what we thought will entail some kind of expenditure. The rest of the trail maintenance is not going to entail any expenditure. It will entail some signage, possibly some wood chips in a couple of spots, but the area around the pond is all very high and dry. There will be a little need for some further 2-plank wide boardwalk right at the end of it, but none of it requiring any kind of expenditure of funds. We already have the signs made up, and you know that's the kind of work that we on the commission can do. So what we put in front of you is just that portion of it that is going to necessitate some kind of expenditure of funds. Certainly, it is our intention to take the steps not just to do the boardwalk, but to do that which is necessary around the rest of the trail, which I think is fairly de minimis, but enough to make sure we get the whole portion of it. While also addressing your concern, I mean, it will be among our priorities and to make sure that work is done before the temporary easement expires, but at the same time emphasizing what we hope will be the primary footpath, which will be the supplemental route coming down through the Sullivan and Pillsbury property.
Right.
So both paths would be pursued.
In terms of timing, I would imagine, as long as it's accepted, that we would try to get the through route to the outlet onto Two Lights Road by the Sullivans and Pillsbury's done first, so that that can become the predominant path. Our concern is obviously to get the other part done in time to prevent the temporary easement from expiring.
Right.
But our first order of business will be the supplemental path.
And I guess that's my main concern, so that is opened up for people.
Yeah, I mean,
because I think that helps the problems that the neighbors have with this.
Yeah.
And I think it's the safest place to come out onto Two Lights Road.
Yeah, the commission absolutely agrees with you. It has been from the outset our intention to try to take all the steps necessary to make that the predominant path that people will want to take. That's what we will do first once it's accepted. We will take the action necessary to preserve the St. Bart's easement or the Chinquette easement after the fact, but in time to prevent the easement from expiring.
Right.
Okay.
Chairman?
Yes.
Question? At the workshop meeting that we held on this, I think it was made pretty clear that the trail itself could be marked with just some boards going down through marking it, or the signs, or whatever. One of the counselors, and I'm not sure who it was, suggested to the Mullins at that time that if they had concerns with people trespassing, et cetera, that they could, in fact, request of the town as part of this whole project, perhaps put a post and rail fence along their property line. That's where the fence was first mentioned, was at the workshop. And I'm not sure that that's out of the question at this point. I don't know if the council or the town has received any formal written request on that yet, but that's where that first came up. And the rest of it, I mean, the easement itself is much longer than what actually needs a boardwalk. We're only talking a small percentage of the trail that needs one fashion or the other. So does that shed any light on what we have, what we need?
Yeah, I think so, but if a fence were put in, I don't think it'd have to be a post and, you know, rail or a heavy fence. I think it could be a wire fence, very similar to what the land trust put in at the Jordan Pond property. It was just a wire fence.
Well,
essentially,
that's so details.
I agree, but.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
The main concern that I have is what you were saying in terms of getting the alternative path established so that it is the predominant way that people...
It's everybody's priority, from the commission through the neighbors out there, Sullivan's, Pillsbury. I mean, everybody is on the same page that that's what we want done first.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's necessary to get the other part at least in front of the council with the decision, so that by the time the easement were to expire, we have all of this ironed out and can take care of it. But it's that supplemental path that is the one that everybody really wants to see up and running first.
We've sort of gotten our discussion going here before our motion, but do I hear a motion?
But before we get to a motion, at the work session, I think we had indicated that there would be an opportunity for any other citizens to discuss this. Will that come after a motion? Or I would like to hear if anyone has anything to say before
I also
motion.
Would. I was thinking of it after a motion, but we can do it either way. I just thought it might be hard until we knew exactly what we were moving.
That makes sense, sure.
Perhaps someone that might strike a chord with someone who might want to comment on what we were...
I'll make a motion then.
Thank you.
To authorize the Conservation Commission to proceed with the St. Bart's easement trail using existing Greenbelt Trail funds, including appropriate signage.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Or is there anyone, well, I'll ask before we discuss any further, is there anyone here who would like to speak? Guess not. Any further discussion?
Yeah, I am concerned about this letter that's just been laid on the desk that we haven't really had a chance to study, expressing the view that a number of neighbors in the neighborhood have found the majority of the neighbors strongly opposed to the boardwalk and so forth. I'd like to know who these people are and what they feel about this thing, and we're not hearing that. We haven't had any time to review this. I live beyond that neighborhood. I mean, I don't live exactly in this neighborhood, so it doesn't affect me personally in any way. But I've spoken with a number of the people down there, and I don't like the idea of the right-of-way going up there anyway. I think that the right-of-way that the Sullivans and Pillsbury's have laid out there is fine. It's an old farm road that they've been using for years anyway. People walk up that way, and that's enough. That's enough intrusion. We've received a letter from Mr. Hollidge pointing out that he's concerned about who might be roaming down there now. At the workshop, there were two members of the council who even expressed being offended that anybody should think that there would be any undesirable people who might use the trail. This very weekend, my mailbox has been vandalized, and I've had some damage to my property with trash thrown on it and so forth in that general area of the town. So I don't think that is, I think that's a legitimate concern on the part of Mr. Hollidge, who wrote the letter, and some of the other folks who didn't write letters but have expressed the same thinking. I think that we have to have this, I think the Conservation Commission has done a wonderful job. I've never seen a more impressive presentation in the 6 years, and this time I've been on the council, than we did at the workshop when they brought forward with all of their work. But I, personally, I cannot support this easement up this way. I think that that the one that's the alternate so-called easement that everybody is seems to be in support of is what should be the easement. I think that's the way the town ought to go. That's my two cents.
Thank you, Councilor Barry. Any further discussion?
I need to ask, could I direct my question to Councilor Barry? I lost it, I think, in there. Are we not talking about, which easement are you talking about? Are we not talking about the Pillsbury-Sullivan easement as being the primary easement that we're...
Yeah.
That we're talking about? So that's the one you don't like?
Oh, no, that's the easement.
Oh, so what is the problem that you, why you can't support it? It's which easement, part of the easement don't you want?
It goes up around this pond and sort of dead ends, and...
Oh, no, it'll go around.
Yeah, well, I know what you're saying, but we've received a lot of letters also, which we've all received from parents of that school. I've watched that school grow from splinters in a field up to a house and a school, and the folks there have done a wonderful job in putting that together. Received a lot of very positive comments from people who have had children there, and I don't think that it's a good idea. This is just one counselor, and I'm outvoted. But
no, you don't think it's a good idea to go up as far as the pond?
That's the idea.
But what will happen to our easement?
I don't care.
Well, then there'll be no easement. Is that what you're saying?
That's a real possibility. As long as we have an easement that goes up...
To catch up with the other path.
Better. But as long as we had the one that's proposed up the bike, the Sullivan property and the Pillsbury property, then we have a place where people can walk.
So your primary, then, concern is to not include the little pond as part of the land trust easement?
Not either. This letter that we've received here says... the pond is of very marginal value. Of course, that's somebody's opinion.
Right.
I don't know what they do use it for. I think it was either a fire stop or for feeding animals. It's a man-made pond. It was created by, I think, the farmers years ago. I'm not sure of that, but I think that's where the pond came from. And it's just been maintained out there and still sits there. I never knew it was there until a few years ago because it's not visible from the road.
I'm sorry.
Question. That's all I'm sorry. Saying.
Councilor Roberts, did you have a comment?
Yes. Obviously, the idea of the town's open space and greenbelt policy is to try and get as much open space spread out all over town, so small sections like that are preserved and not lost. And the Conservation Commission for the last 30 years has been acquiring and doing an excellent job of it. I spoke with Mr. Hollidge today, and Ted is not concerned, as long as we emphasize that the other trail that goes down to Two Lights, rather than going by his house, is the one that we emphasize. If every time we tried to have open space or green belts, if we paid attention strictly to the neighbor's concerns, Cape Elizabeth wouldn't be what it is today. We wouldn't have any open space in anybody's neighborhood. And we need to continue to protect these things. The school may only be there another 3 years. We don't know. But that neighborhood is going to be there for hundreds of years, we hope. And we need to preserve these spaces. And if we just capitulate and not preserve them, then the character of the town is going to be adversely affected. And I don't want to see that happen. The number of people using this trail is going to be very limited. It's going to be the folks in Broad Cove that are going to be using it. If it hadn't been for all the publicity that we've gotten over this easement, nobody in town would have even known it was there. Obviously, people do now. But again, It's a nice little skating pond. It's a nice, quiet refuge from the neighborhoods out behind when you walk up through there.
Yeah, we
it would be a destination. I have the mic right now. Thank you. It would be a nice little quiet space in the back that'll be a destination location. It will not be a throughway. Folks traveling from Broad Cove to Two Lights would use the other access. It'd be much more appropriate and easier for them to travel on. And we need to continue to support the Conservation Commission in making sure that these trails get in everywhere in town so that no one neighborhood is impacted. I have one in my backyard. It's no problem. People out there enjoying the open space, and they behave themselves admirably. We asked Maureen to show us the studies that showing when green belts go in, there is no increase in crime. We've addressed all of those issues, and I hope that we'll proceed with this tonight and recognize that the Conservation Commission will do the best they can to keep the cost as low as possible by using the least expensive boardwalk possible given the area, with the right to use the higher raised form of some type over the most extreme portion. So I'm definitely going to be voting for this. As a former member of that commission, I know the effort that's been put into that, into the green belts around town, and it's we need to go in that route. So thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Roberts. Any further? Councilor Lynch.
Yes. I wanted to address a couple of things that Councilor Berry raised that were raised in this letter that we received tonight in opposition to the trail. I don't think there are any new issues here. The landowner has made it clear that he does not support the trail. However, this is not a case of the town taking any land or legal interest from anyone. The town owns the right to access the trail right now. The town will lose that right if we don't develop a trail around it. There are people in the neighborhood who currently use it. Some of the people who object to having a trail developed, that is a little boardwalk, are people who are using the pond themselves right now. I think we would be remiss if we don't take the actions necessary to preserve the town's rights. And by that, it's our neighbors and people who live in this town. I'm with Jack. It's a nice little trail, but people aren't going to travel from one neighborhood to another to use it. It's really a neighborhood trail. I think there's a lot of support for the trail, including around the pond within the neighborhood. Certainly, I've heard a lot of support for it. I understand the Mullins' concern about the access right near their school, and I appreciate that, and I think the Conservation Commission is working and has stated tonight on the record that they will be doing everything they can to develop the Pillsbury-Sullivan access so that we don't have access along the side of the Mullins property. I guess I also want to say I think the Sullivans and the Pillsburys deserve a lot of credit and thanks from the town for stepping forward and coming up with a proposal that I think alleviated some of the neighbors' concerns, perhaps not all, but has gone a long way to address this issue. So I'll be supporting this. I think trails are important. Certainly something I hear about from people all of the time. And this is not a case of taking anyone's property rights. This is a case of maintaining and protecting the rights that the town has currently for its citizens. So I'll be supporting this.
Thank you, Councilor Lynch. Any further comments?
Just a perennial concern I have for marking trails well. I think that's a very important part of, you know, having people stay on the trails and respect private property and that sort of thing. So again, simultaneously getting those signs up.
Thank you. Any further comments? Yes, Councilor McGinty.
As you know, I've tried to look at this thing every which way to try to maintain the easement with
the minimal impact on the property owners around there and on the property itself. And was forcibly told finally that this is it. This is what it comes down to if we want to maintain the easement. And I have to agree with Councilor Roberts that, you know, when you have the opportunity to preserve open space, you got to hang on to it or you're going to lose it. And so I'll be supporting this this measure.
Any further comments? I would like to, before we vote, take this opportunity to thank not only the Sullivans and the Pillsburys, who I think have been extremely generous in their offer of an additional trail connecting these two neighborhoods, but I want to thank the Conservation Committee and Mike Duddy for all their hard work on this. I know it's been sort of a long road, and it's been a lot of work and a lot of tromping around in the mud, and on behalf of the town, I just want to thank you. It's been very well presented, and I know you've put a lot of hard work and excellent thought into your proposals, so I thank you. I also want to thank everybody who has offered us opinions, comments, their points of view on this issue. It has been somewhat controversial among some people in the neighborhood, particularly the Mullins, who are impacted by it somewhat directly. But it's been, for the most part, a very civil discourse, and I want to thank all the parents of the students at the school who wrote us letters, and neighbors and other people from Broad Cove, who also gave us their points of view on this. I think it's helped bring us all up to speed on this issue and has allowed us to work through the process carefully to make sure we've heard everybody's point of view. I know I've given it a lot of careful thought, and I'm sure all the other counselors have too. And we've tried to balance the needs of the people most directly impacted by this with the needs of all the citizens of Cape Elizabeth to have access to open space and to have a greenbelt system we can all be proud of. I will be supporting this. One of the main reasons I will be supporting this is that I think that unless we maintain our easement across the so-called St. Bart's easement across that property that the Chinquettes now own, that that is the only way that the town can ensure that the public will forever have access to that property. If we do not maintain our easement, who knows? We're just giving up our property right, and I don't see, it may have a bad effect on the very people who use that property the most right now, which is the neighbors and the Mullins. So I think we are preserving their right to use this property and the rights of all Cape citizens to do so. So I hear no further comments. So it's been moved and seconded. All in favor? 6 opposed? Councillor Berry. It passes. Thank you very much. Okay. Moving on to item number 94. The playground, Cape Play Organization, would like to come to the mic and identify yourself for the viewers at home, please. Let us know how it's going and what's up.
Good evening. My name is Laura Briggs, and I'm co-chair of Cape Play together with Lisa Silverman-Gent, who's here in the audience. I realized as I went over my notes for preparing for tonight that it's been almost 9 months to the day since we were last here before you with the Playground Committee, seeking your approval for the Playground Committee's recommendations. And I guess I would like to say that I think in those 9 months we've been quite productive and have given birth to quite a bit of activity. And therefore we're here tonight to ask your approval to proceed with construction this summer, beginning immediately as soon as school gets out. And my understanding is that by being here today, that gives us enough time to proceed with, or the town, the time to proceed with the bid process and contracting measures that would need to take place before June when construction would begin. We're hoping tonight to do two things. First, I thought I would briefly go over with you our fundraising efforts and what we've achieved. And then I'd like to turn the mic over to Pat Carroll, who's the landscape architect who's been working on this project for 2 or 3 years now, so that he can share with you the proposed improvements to be made to both the middle school and Pond Cove playgrounds, as well as an overview of the bid process that we're proposing. Cape Play initiated its work shortly after the council challenged the citizens of Cape Elizabeth to try to find additional funds to match the $150,000 in bonded funds that were already available. We proceeded with a multi-faceted strategy for raising funds for playgrounds that consisted of several mass mailings to citizens in the community, a gala auction, which the chair mentioned and was held this past weekend, several family events that were designed to spread awareness of the issue as well as do some fundraising. We've also been actively seeking support from corporations in the area as well as citizens who've had a long-term interest and commitment to this community. All of those efforts to date have netted $95,000 in additional funds to match the $150,000 in town bonded monies. You'll see if you turn to attachment one in the report we submitted to you that those numbers are somewhat different because we've had a very busy week this past week, and I just wanted to update you on that. Shortly after we met with you in June, together with the town and Pat Carroll, we submitted a grant for land and water conservation funding, and we received that grant, a $25,000 grant, which is the maximum you can receive for the middle school playground. So that is one piece of these monies. That has been supplemented by $7,000 in additional grant monies from the Harmon Family Foundation, which is a foundation that has some local connections here in Cape Elizabeth. Subsequent to that, we did a mass mailing in November, both to all of the citizens and households of Cape Elizabeth, as well as separate mailings to parents of the middle school children and Pond Cove Elementary children. And through that effort, we actually raised close to $20,000. We've had an update since we prepared these numbers a week ago. We've discovered that there was actually $4,000 in additional funds that had been donated. We've also held several family events. As you see in your notes here, we had $1,178 from those events. But about a week ago, a very successful mother-daughter tea was held. And I'd like to thank the girls from Brownie Troop 1405 who helped waitress for that event. It was a full house, and they raised over $1,000 for playgrounds through their efforts. So those additional monies can also be added here. Furthermore, we have just found out that Oakhurst Dairy has donated $2,000 to this process, and we'd like to thank them for their support for Cape Elizabeth's playgrounds. And finally, on last Friday, we did hold a gala auction, and we've raised over $19,000 from that auction. We were very pleased by the support that we've received and continue to expect to receive additional support over the next few weeks as word gets out. The proceeds from the upcoming Pond Cove Fund Run have been dedicated to playgrounds, and the estimate can be fairly accurate since this event has been held for several years. As well as a School Pops program, which is one of those kind of school receipt programs. We've raised significant funds from that and expect more over the next few months as well. In total today, when expenses have been factored out, we have $241,000 available today for the playground project.
So that's your net income out?
Our net right now, yes. Now there are maybe a few additional expenses that roll in the next week or two. But we, as I mentioned, expect to also have some additional funds from the run. We're having a movie night, so we expect that we're going to have some additional, a few thousand more over the next few weeks, both mostly in terms of funds and then probably maybe perhaps up to 1,000 more in expenses. So we feel very comfortable that we're in a good position. We're pleased. It's been a long, hard year for many of us, but we're very enthused about the support that we've received from the community. We've been actively looking at different equipment vendors. Pat has been working diligently to refine the plans, and I'd like to turn it over to him so that he can share with you what is proposed in terms of improvements, and then we'd be glad to take any questions you might have.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to take a moment just to pull this easel over here so we can put the boards up on it. Well, Laura was right and wrong in one sense, because I really haven't been working on this for 2.5 years. It seems like 2.5 years, but it's really only been a year and a half that I've actually been involved. I know the committee has been working diligently for probably close to a year before I got involved, and my hat's really off to this group of people. They've really stuck with the project, and there's been a lot of good, positive, upbeat kind of talk and conversations and activity, and I think they're about to make this thing happen. The plan I wanted to go through with you tonight is really based on a lot on the concept plan that was presented, I think, about 8 or 9 months ago to you. And several months ago, we met with Mike, and at that point in time, we went through the funding, and Mike had basically authorized us to proceed with developing a design based on a budget of $240,000. So what you see tonight is really has those parameters involved around it. And in fact, it's really based on a construction budget of around $200,000 with a 10% contingency in there. So there is some buffer in there in case bids do come in high, but we feel pretty confident that that we're well within the budget that was established and also within the funding that the committee has available. I'm going to start with Pond Cove, and then we'll talk about the middle school, and then we'll talk a little bit about the equipment pieces themselves. This is the Pond Cove school here. This is the library here. And the existing playground for the Pond Cove kids consists of, there's a hard surface area right here. It's about half of this gray area that's indicated. And then there's a playground structure that's actually located right in here, kind of an old wooden playground structure. And the rest of the site, as you know, is kind of the sea of wood chips down to an existing structure that's down below. The intent here is to actually expand the hard surface area by double. So we'll increase significantly the amount of hard surface play area available to the kids, and then create a soft play area with two different pieces of playground structure that's actually located just slightly to the south of the existing play area. And now, in order to do this, what we're going to do is actually come in here and we're going to remove the existing structure, and we've actually talked with Bob Malley, and he's going to do some of that removal work for us. Regrade this site. There's about 200 cubic yards of ledge that's going to come out of this hillside here. We had Public Works come out and dug several test pits out here for us. There is, amazingly, there's no ledge in this area down in here, but there's kind of a finger of ledge that runs right down through here. It's pretty apparent there's exposed ledge currently at the top right in this area, and there's another piece of exposed ledge right in here, but it seems to drop off pretty dramatically on both sides. So, but we have calculated what we think is about 200 yards of ledge that will come out, and that's to excavate down to a depth that they can install this equipment. There's an existing basketball court, hard surface court, up on top here. In the original master plan, it was envisioned that the basketball activity would move down to the south end of the playground. Due to the fact that there is talk about expansion at the Pond Cove School and the uncertainty about when the rest of the playground is going to get developed, the feeling was that we really ought to try to maintain a basketball court up here, because it may be years and years before that ever happens. So that basketball court will remain. There will be an accessible route that's a new sidewalk that comes in, provides access to the library, and then provides access on up to this upper area. And what happens is that this playground will actually be terraced. There's 2.5 feet of grade between the upper area and the lower area. The upper area playground will be at grade with the existing basketball court, and then there'll be a slope grade down to this lower area here. Access to the upper area will be through this pathway, and will also be through a sidewalk and a set of steps that'll come in directly up into here. There's an existing timber wall that wraps around this portion of the playground now, and that will be removed and replaced with one of these segmented concrete retaining walls that will be at seat height. They'll have a cap on it. It'll be a very nice place for kids to kind of sit as they do now out here. And that will continue around here and form another seat wall on this side of the hard surface area as a back to this soft play area here. The intent would be that we would leave the existing paving in here, and we would there would be new pavement construction in this zone, and then we would overlay the entire thing, so that when all is said and done, it's going to look like one new entirely repaved hard surface area. We have met with Dr. Frisella, we met with the building committee, and this rectangle in here is what I got today from the building committee's architect, Bob Howe, as their proposed footprint, at least in a very conceptual preliminary way, as to where the new addition to Pond Cove would be. So we have taken their considerations into account here, and we believe, and they believe, that this new proposed playground will not impact any future development or future expansion of the Pond Cove School in that direction. So that's pretty much what's going on with Pond Cove. Again, we're stepping this playground down, trying to take advantage of the topography and to minimize the amount of ledge that has to come out of here, and I think it'll also add a lot of attractiveness and something kind of unique and kind of neat about the playground. The intent would be we would have a structure up here, perhaps with two slides that kind of take up that grade change and drop down into the lower playground area. And we are indicating this blue in here would be a rubberized surface on that banking. It would be a 3-to-1 banking that would go up 2.5 feet. It would be rubberized surface so that kids could either run back and forth through here. It would provide a safety zone underneath the slide area, and we could get some color out there. It could provide a pretty nice, attractive kind of banding between the two. Any questions on Pond Cove at this point? The middle school playground is a little simpler. Currently, the existing playground sits right in here. Our intent on this, on the base bid of this project, would be to remove the playground structure, create this area for a new playground structure, and install the new playground structure itself. At this point in time, with our $240,000 budget, the additional hard surface paving here and the sidewalk connection is not in the budget at this point in time. But the intent would be that we would design it and bid it out as an alternate to the bid, and assuming that maybe the bids come in low, or assuming that the committee raises more money, or assuming that the contingency money that we have, which is about $20,000, is not eaten up in some cost or another, it's hopeful that there would be funding available to accomplish that work. I think it's pretty important to the project, and unfortunately it's $23,000 worth of work that's pushing us up over the limit. But the intent would be that ultimately there would be a soft play area, a hard play area here. These are swings that went in last year. There is, as part of this playground, an additional tire swing that would be located out here. So that's pretty much it on the middle school. These are just enlargements of the playground equipment themselves. As Laura indicates in her brochure, the two pieces of equipment at Pond Cove, the committee has spent quite a bit of time researching playgrounds, visiting playgrounds, meeting with reps, pouring through catalogs. I've given them more catalogs, and they've come up with a lot of vendors, and they've spent enormous amounts of time researching this, and feel very strongly that a company called Landscape Structures is going to provide the best equipment and meet their needs in the best way. So the intent right now is to purchase this, the town would purchase this as a sole source, and we would competitively bid the equipment on the middle school, and that's tied to the grant that Laura talked about, the LCW grant. That does require competitive bidding, and we would bid that competitively as a separate item. This indicates the equipment that has been selected with the committee and Landscape Structures. There's a double double swing here, a large platform, and there's probably 25 or 30 pieces of equipment that, if I told you the names of them, you wouldn't recognize what any of it did anyway. But this is a kind of a monkey bar ring that you swing around on. This is a series of rings that are kind of like monkey bars again that you kind of move forward on. There's two or three slides in this lower piece and this large slide in the upper piece. All in all, it really does provide quite a bit of play for kids. I think it will accommodate well over 100 to 120 kids. We looked at, one of the options we did look at is combining all of these pieces into one and not doing this upper part of the site. And actually it was cheaper to split the two. The price we got from Landscape Structures was actually more economical to split it. And I think it provides a larger space for the kids to kind of move around and gather. So I think that, you know, there are some benefits to it. It also allows us, there will be space here that some individual pieces of equipment could be added onto over the years. Yes?
Pat, what is the expected life expectancy of these, of the structure, and is there any guarantee of replacement parts being available for X number of years out?
Yes, the rep for Landscape Structures indicated to me that it's not uncommon for these things to last 20 to 30 years. So they're very high quality, they're very well made, and they you know, this company has been in business for a long time. They do supply parts. They supply parts for all their past equipment, and they're always kind of on the cutting edge as far as new pieces of equipment, new ways to fasten things so that they're safer. They meet all the current codes as far as safety and accessibility and all of that. I think it's a very well made piece of equipment, and it'll last a long time. For the middle school, again, this is a scheme that was worked out with Landscape Structures, but you can see this is the boundary here. This again has the double slide. This actually has, I think, three or four slides associated with it, as well as some other pieces of equipment that are geared more towards older kids. That was part of the criteria, was this was really geared towards older kids, this was geared towards younger kids. And again, there is space in the middle school as well as the elementary school for additional pieces of equipment in that zone. So.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Carroll. Are there any questions?
How comfortable are you, Mr. Carroll, with the adequacy of the contingency? And is there some track record or industry standards?
Yeah. The way that we typically split out contingencies is that there's a 5% bid, what we call a bid contingency, and a 5% construction contingency. Typically what happens is that bid contingency is, you're allowed to use that at the bid table. So say the bids come in and we've got a construction bid of, or a budget of $200,000 and it comes in at $205,000. You could use that money that day to kind of award that contract. Or you could use it to purchase, you know, an alternate. Say there was an alternate for some benches, and you could go ahead and purchase that. The construction contingency, typically 5% is really pretty standard in the industry. I think on this project that it actually may be high, because the playground manufacturers that we've talked to have given us pretty firm prices, and that 5% is based on the total cost including all the play equipment. So I seriously doubt that we would have, you know, $10,000 worth of additional work in construction of this site.
And then I just had one other question. You mentioned that you had met with the school building committee, and I think perhaps you've met with just a couple of representatives and not the full committee?
That's right.
And the reason I raise it is I'm on the school building committee, and I've seen at the last meeting, which was just last week, four or five different proposals, and I believe that one or more of the proposals, schematics that we saw, were in this particular location where the playground is. So I understand you've had a conversation with Dr. Frisella, and there may be some leaning of some people towards one particular site, but I would feel more comfortable getting a letter from the school department or the school building committee before you make a major investment that says we clearly understand this is where the playground is going, and we're not going to be looking there, because I think there were a couple of...
Well, I talked with Bob Howe today, and in fact, he sent me over the plan showing that location. He said, at this point, this is the preferred location, so...
This item is on the school board agenda for tomorrow evening as well, for them to review the location and indicate their approval.
Councilor McGinty.
As recent as this morning, we read in the paper that there's increasing enrollment at in our schools. High school obviously isn't affected. Is this, you mentioned like 100 kids or something can play on this. Will this equipment and playgrounds, both of them, accommodate our increasing enrollment? I mean, or is there a timeline on it? I mean, is there some formula that this playground equipment will, you know, I don't know, 200 kids can climb all over it, but if you get the 250, then, you know, you have...
Well, the reality is that this playground equipment is just one component of their play during recess.
Right.
I mean, they have hard surface courts, they have, you know, there are kids that play soccer and kickball and all these different other activities. So, you know, I think there's typically about 180 kids out there on the playground at a time. This accommodates well over half or two-thirds of those kids on this equipment. So Tom Eismeyer is pretty comfortable with that.
Well, one of the issues, and Councilor Lynch alluded to it, was if they build that building there, it's going to obviously take out some of the current playground area.
Right.
You know, so,
and I think that is an issue, because what it's taking out is kind of the free play area.
Right.
And, you know, that's got to be supplemented somewhere. And I know when we met with Dr. Frisella, there was discussion about perhaps, you know, utilizing that courtyard between the middle and Pond Cove for that type of play or something else. But, you know, I think it's a pretty tight site for the number of kids that school supports.
Wanted to make sure that we're thinking about that.
Councilor Roberts.
Yeah, I know that there has been an awful lot of work put into this whole thing, and I noticed that Pat has several other people from the committee, and could you introduce the other folks that are with you tonight that are on the committee?
Sure. Tina Harnden is sitting in the third row back, and Lisa Silverman Gent is Trish Vickery in the back.
Thank you. Didn't mean to put you on the spot, Pat.
Terrible with names.
Are there any more?
May I ask one more question on behalf of the Foursquare constituency in this town? Whenever I go to the playground, which is with some frequency, there's always a huge group of kids playing Foursquare. Is there room in this plan to preserve the Foursquare, which... believe me, is
there's not
extremely
room to
popular.
It, but there's room to double the size of the area. That was really the guiding factor on increasing the hard surface play area, was, you know, that kids spend their whole recess standing in line to play Foursquare.
And I gather, while some may think that a frivolous question, those Foursquare players are future voters, and I'm just watching over their interest.
I was talking to a couple teachers down at Pond Cove, and I asked, I said, well, what kind of playground? And they said, if you just gave more Foursquare, they'd all be happy. So obviously, it's a big deal with the kids that have Foursquare. I don't even know what it is.
Go to the mic so that people...
Could you talk about the ad alternate
The ad alternate item that's in there is $23,000 that essentially goes towards hard surface area at the middle school. Currently today, there is no hard surface area, so those children who are aggressively playing foursquare in fourth grade go to fifth grade and not only find themselves in middle school, but suddenly can't play some of the things that they're used to playing out there. So it's our deepest hope that we'll either be able to raise additional funds over the next couple of months to have sufficient money to do that, or through the savings that Pat has talked about potentially having, we'll be able to do that.
Could you also comment on your timeline for this? I mean, presuming, just for the people who may be watching at home.
The timeline, and correct me if I'm wrong, Pat, is essentially to begin the bid process shortly after we meet with you. And then once school is out, to begin construction immediately, the site work would start, and that should take 4 to 6 weeks. And then after that, installation of the equipment should take place before the end of August. So the goal is to complete all of the site work and installation before school opens in September.
For both schools?
For both schools, correct.
Thank you. Further questions, comments?
Just a comment. You can tell which one of the council was a four-square champion when she was in school.
We didn't hear about it then. It's a new game, Henry. We're too old.
You can tell which one is young.
Right.
Oh, we won't go there. We won't go there. Councilor Fritz.
I'd just like to praise the Cape Play for all the fundraising and the work you've put in. I think when we challenged the committee, I think it seemed like a really daunting task, but my goodness, you've really, really taken on the challenge and raised a great deal of money. And since you're on the building committee, Mary Ann, I hope you would discourage this addition that's shown on this plan, because I really do. I spend a fair amount of time over there working with kids in the garden that they have in the spot along the building and see what, you know, what the space is like and how valuable that space is for the kids out there playing. And I'd like to see that playground cut in any way by that.
I certainly would not support any location that would interfere with the playground, especially after funds have been allocated. The concern I have is if the school is 2 or 3 years off, institutional memories are sometimes not as good as we would like, and that's why I always, maybe it's training that I've had in the past, but I like to get it in writing.
Perhaps that's a good moment to ask our town manager, Mr. McGovern, if he has any concerns, issues. Does Public Works have any concerns or issues? This seems like a very well thought out plan, but I just want to get the word.
There are no issues or concerns. To the contrary, as was mentioned, we met a couple months ago to take stock of where this was at that point in time, and they said, oh, we'll raise $240,000 by March 1. I kind of,
ew,
I don't know. And then, anyway, we'll go for it. And they made the 240 goal, and they moved forward with the plans. They reduced the scope of the plans to reflect the reality of fundraising at this point, the reality of budgeting. Did a very good job of that. And just today, in addition to everything else, I don't know if the committee is aware of it, but we received another $700 in checks from citizens unsolicited, including a check from an older resident for $500. So it's definitely true that individuals of all ages and all backgrounds have been supporting this effort. So it's been a good project to be working on it, on the periphery of it, and the individuals who you see in the audience have really done an awful lot of work, some of them for as long as 2.5 years, bringing it to this point. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, I also would like to congratulate you on doing such a wonderful job. I'm very impressed. It's very hard going to raise this much money, and I'm extremely impressed with how well you have raised money, but also the quality of the plan seems really excellent and will be a really great experience. I don't have for Pond Cove and middle school kids. I don't have any kids left there, but I'm impressed, and I think my kids would have liked what you've planned very much, and I'm sure the kids who will be there in the future will like it very much. So congratulations to Laura and Lisa and everyone else, and Pat and everyone else on the committee. I think it's a great project. Yes, Councilor.
Speaking of institutional knowledge, I didn't bring my folder with me tonight, but whatever happened to Fort Williams?
Oh, the Fort Williams piece.
Yeah, piece of it.
It's coming.
I just can't remember.
Laura will speak.
Your institutional memory has faded.
You may have to ask us about that when we're a little less tired, but Fort Williams was originally slated to be phase three of the development process for playgrounds. The first phases looked at doing the middle school and Pond Cove. The second phase looked at improvements to the field at Pond Cove, that large field. The idea was that it would be grassed over. At this point, the committee's instinct is to postpone that particular phase until the issues revolving around the school improvements are resolved. It seems like that may be an appropriate fit for that project, and it seems premature to go ahead with that without knowing where that project is going. So that takes us next to Fort Williams. I had the fortune to meet the other night with the Fort Williams Foundation, and they were very supportive of this effort. I understand that the Fort Williams Committee is also aware of the project and comfortable with it. And I believe that come June or July, once we're completed with this, it will be a time to sit back and discuss where Cape Play goes next and who might like to take the reins from Lisa and I. And if there's anyone out there, please call us. We'd be glad to help out, but we are looking for someone to take a leadership role on that. But we've heard a lot of encouragement from the community on Fort Williams. My sense is it would be a different type of fundraising campaign that would be geared more towards corporations in the area. This has been very much of a grassroots effort. The vast majority of our funding has come from relatively small size donations, where Fort Williams may have the capability to receive larger donations because of its community character and the fact that it's perceived to be a regional asset. So we expect it would be a different type of campaign, but we're hopeful that there will be one. And again, we're looking for someone who'd like to take the reins up, and we'd be glad to share our information with them and also put them in touch with organizations such as the Fort Williams Foundation.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I was just going to say, do we have a motion?
I would move to authorize Cape Play to proceed with the first phase of the playground development.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Any further discussion, comments? Councilor Lynch, did you want to make this contingent upon the approval of the site of the school board for to address your concern?
I can add that to my motion.
The school building committee is in a position of approving their site. All I'm looking for is a letter that says we've all met and we all agree that this is the appropriate spot for the playground. I don't know that it needs to be part of the motion.
Complicate that.
I don't want to complicate.
I didn't want to leave that loose end if you wanted to deal with it.
My understanding is we'll be looking for that in the school board minutes so that it's an official reflection of school policy.
Okay, great. Thank you. It's been moved and seconded. Anything further? No. All in favor? It's unanimous. Congratulations. Thank you very much. Okay, Pat, could I ask you just to move that easel, only because it's reflecting these lights right into my eyes, at least. I'm semi-blinded. Thank you. Item number 95, Mr. Manager?
Do you want to introduce it?
Yes, would you introduce it? I wanted to see if Matt Sturgis was here, but he's not.
No. This is a homestead exemption that was removed in error from property at 45 Stonegate Road. The amount of the proposed abatement is $139.02 for fiscal year 2000 and $142.10 for fiscal year 2001. The assessor and I both recommend that it be granted.
Councilor McGinn.
I move that we grant the assessments as noted. The abatements as noted.
Second.
Lowest estimate. Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Item number 96. Ms. Lane, would you like to say anything about this? It's about burial fees and foundation fees.
Yes, thank you very much. This is the time of year that we set burial fees. We are preparing, believe it or not, for the spring opening of Riverside Cemetery. I'm pleased to report that Manager McGovern, Bob Melly, and myself are recommending that we hold the line this year again for burial fees and the placement of foundation fees. We will be entering our second year of providing full services through our Public Works Department at Riverside. As we do each year, we'll come back again next year and see how the budget looks, how our expenditures look. And then that way we'll have a complete fiscal year behind us to really look to make sure that we are just simply covering our costs with the burials. So I would recommend that the fees, as you see before you, be established for the 2002 burial season.
Thank you. It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Most likely applicant.
Councilor Roberts?
After we vote, I just have a comment I'd like to add to it.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. All in favor? It's unanimous. Your comment?
Obviously, the cemetery board brought this forward, and the cemetery board is one man light or one woman light. So if there's anybody out there who would like to apply for that position, please get in touch with Deborah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Item number 97 has to do with the dog warrant. Ms. Lane?
Yes, thank you. Before you in your packet, you do have the 2002 dog warrant. Basically, the state law requires the municipal officers to direct the animal control officer to contact unlicensed dog owners. Assuming that you sign this warrant tonight, letters will be going out to approximately 200 folks tomorrow. And the warrant gives them, or the violation notice, I should say, gives them 7 days which to register their dog, or they can be subject to court action if they do not register the dog.
Get your dog.
So I'd recommend that you sign the warrant as presented.
Thank you very much. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
It's been moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
This is the Attorney's Full Employment Act. Take them to court with your dog license.
I take it there's no further discussion. We'll just let that one lie. Let that sleeping dog lie.
Oh, dear.
Oh, that was really bad. I'm sorry. I apologize. All those in favor, please. It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Dogmatic.
Okay. Item number 98. Mr. McGovern, would you like to introduce this?
This is a quitclaim deed from D. Brock and Helene C. Hornby. They reside on the corner of Shore Road and Ocean View Road. And when we were doing planning for reconstruction of some of the sewers in Mountain View Park, we noted that a portion of Ocean View Road was actually on the Hornby's property. We worked closely with the Hornbys. They were extremely cooperative throughout the process, actually working on and off on this for about 6 months. And I was very pleased that the Hornbys have returned to us the quitclaim deed signed, and upon approval of the council, this would be filed in the Registry of Deeds, and we would be able to have Island View Road as a proper town street.
So is this Ocean View or
Island View? Island View, excuse me.
Okay, it's Island View.
Yep.
Okay.
I get those views mixed up.
Just checking. So item number 98 on the agenda should say Island View?
Island View.
Okay, just check.
My fault.
Right, all right.
Good thing I'm not in the rescue.
Good point.
I move that we accept the quitclaim deed.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Councilor Roberts?
Just one question. Is the rock wall that is there now on town property because of this, or is it on the Hornby's property still?
If you noticed in the deed, The Hornbys reserve the right to keep and maintain the stone pillar where it presently exists on the property, conveyed hereby. It's conveyed to us, but they return the right to keep it and maintain it. Judge Hornby and Mrs. Hornby were quite concerned, rightfully and appropriately, that historical stone wall be kept.
Yeah, I drove by there today and took a look at it, and I thought, gee, that looks awful close. All right, thank you.
Okay, any further questions or discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Item number 99, which has to do with a drainage easement. And Mr. McGovern, would you like to say anything about this?
The McDougal, Ms. McDougal and Mr. Haskell were building a home out in back of Pleasant Avenue that's been reviewed and approved by the planning board. As part of that approval, it was conditioned upon them providing the town a drainage easement, and they have now done that, and it would be in order for the council to accept the drainage easement, which would then give us the right to all the rights contained within the drainage easement document.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
I move acceptance of the drainage easement as described herein.
How about a second?
Second.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Moving on to item number 100. Referring the proposed fiscal year 2003 general fund budget and special funds budgets to the Finance Committee. Do we have these?
You, at this point, you only have a summary. I expect that the original deadline was due to receive it the 15th yes. of March, and that deadline will be kept.
Okay.
But it's, the school numbers were reported in the morning paper, and the municipal budget, the spending rate is up 3%. Regrettably, proposed revenues are down $132,000. So it will be a challenging process for the Finance Committee.
Councilor McGinty.
I move that we refer the proposed fiscal year 2003 general fund budget and special funds budgets to the Finance Committee.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Any discussion or comment? All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Before we move to enter executive session, I just wanted to mention we have copies of this article. Well,
you have them all.
I have them all, yes, but I want to just pass out copies of this proposed article about the municipal projects, all of the different spending on municipal projects that has been done in town. And are you looking for input from the councilors on this article?
Mm-hmm.
So we can pass these.
This is a proposed article for the Courier, for the Portland.
For the website, wherever else who wants to.
Right. It just explains sort of the status of municipal projects, the financial status of municipal projects that have been done basically since the pool, right? Since the pool. It includes things like the playgrounds, the police station, fire station, the Robinson Woods purchase, just a bunch of stuff. So please review it, and if you have comments, let the manager know. Okay, item number 101. Yes?
Before you do that, before you go into executive session, Councilor Barry also has, there's a board and commission orientation for Thursday, March 21, and some of the councilors may be asked to do certain things there, and just wanted you to touch base with Councilor Barry on that.
Thank you.
We forget, Henry.
I'm writing myself a note. Okay, item 101.
Just before you do that, I was just wondering whether, let me see, this schedule that I had one item, I guess it was a workshop on April 11th, that we are we not putting that on our calendar, or are we saving it?
That, I believe, is our regularly held Thursday workshop date. That's the same week as the council meeting, right?
Yeah.
That's the Thursday of a council meeting week. So what's the, I think.
Well, it was not included on this list. So
I think Mr. McGovern left it off because we have so many meetings. We have 8 or 10 meetings coming up for budget. So unless there is some particular subject that we feel the need to have a workshop on the 11th, I think we can strike that date. And let speak now if anyone has any concern about that. I don't hear any concern.
Along the same vein, are we also striking a workshop that was previously scheduled for this week?
the 14th.
The one for this week, we had originally talked about doing the manager's evaluation, but presuming that we are going, item 101 is to enter executive session to talk about that, so I don't think we'll need it Thursday.
Okay.
So we will strike that. Okay, great. There's a list attached to this agenda of all the upcoming meetings, and I won't go through them all, but they detail mostly budget meetings and some of our regular council meetings that are coming up. And these dates will, are all on the website, I presume.
If anyone looks at agendas under the website, goes to town council, they all appear at the end of the town council.
Right, and all meetings are at 7:30 p.m. in the town hall. So, should we do the citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda now?
Yes.
Yes. The Cape Current reporter might have a comment.
Anybody out there want to say anything? Add anything? No. Okay.
So I'll move that we enter.
Yes, can we finally do 101 here?
Move that we enter executive session to discuss the annual evaluation of the town manager.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor?
And it's not anticipated that we'll take any action, public action, after this
addition.
Right. So we will be ending the meeting. We will not be coming back into public session here after we are done with our executive session. It's been moved and seconded. All in favor? It's unanimous. Great. Thank you very much. Oh, do we need a motion? Well, no, we can't adjourn. Never mind. We'll adjourn the executive session. Thank you very much.